previous lesson, you learned how to determine if something was unusual or the probability of it, given a null hypothesis and given the population standard deviation. But that's usually not the case. So you learned z-test for a mean previously. Most of the time, you're actually going to be doing a t-test for the mean. So the t-test is just like the z-test, but we use the z-test when we know the population standard deviation. So the tip off to you, if you see sigma, that is the z-test, and it's very important that you have that symbol there. And if you don't see sigma, if you see s, then we do a t-test. All right, the null hypothesis is pretty similar. We say that our mu is some value. It's not the mean from the data. It's not your statistic. It's the hypothesized mean instead. We have three forms of the alternate hypothesis. If it's not equal to, we could assume, well, maybe it's greater than, or it's less than, or it's just not equal to. Remember to identify what the parameter is in context, okay? So, let's go ahead and look at a coffee machine that dispenses coffee into paper cups. You're supposed to get 10 ounces of coffee, but the amount varies slightly from cup to cup. Here are the amounts measured in a random sample, 20 cups. Is there evidence that the machine is shortchanging customers? So whenever we're looking to see if we have evidence, first of all, we have to say, what are we assuming going in? And what is the possible alternative that we might change our mind from the assumption to the other? So our null hypothesis is, yeah, everybody's getting 10 ounces of coffee per cup. And we're worried about shortchanging, so we're going to say that the alternate is that they get less than 10 ounces of coffee per cup. Now, conditions are the same as for when we did a t-interval. Well, yeah, we did those t-intervals. So we still have a large normal. Our sample size needs to be greater than or equal to 30. Or if I tell you the population is normal, you're great. If it's not greater than or equal to 30, or if I don't tell you the population is normal, ideally you would make a histogram or a box plot to see if it looks, it looks fine. No skew, no outliers. That's usually what you're worried about. Random. The data come from a well-designed random sample or randomized experiment. Note that being representative is the goal, all right? So for our coffee example, it's not greater than 30, so we have to check the plot. And it's roughly symmetric, it's unimodal, and again, no major skew, no outliers, so we're fine. Random, well, we told you in the problem that we had randomly selected cups, so we're fine there. Now, we're going to do one for a company working on a battery. A company has set a goal of developing a battery that lasts over 5 hours in continuous use. Based on the sample at right, is there evidence they met their goal? So we're going to do hypothesis and conditions again. So we want to know if it lasts over 5 hours. So the null would be, it's just 5 hours, all right? The alternate is that it's more than 5 hours. Now here I actually do have a histogram already made of these lifespans. And if I wouldn't have to do that if I had a sample size greater than or equal to 30, but I don't, so I have to plot it. And it's roughly symmetric and unimodal, so we're fine. And random, we don't know. It doesn't say random, so we're going to have to assume that the sample's random or at least representative. So what do we calculate next? So now we're changing test statistics. Before we would have a z-score, now we're going to have t, so instead of z. And the formula looks real similar. It's x bar minus mu, so that looks the same. But the difference is instead of having sigma down here, we now have s. And we still are dividing by the square root of the sample size, so don't forget to do that. You will use your alternate hypothesis to determine how to shade the t-distribution and what probability you're looking for. So you can have a left-sided alternate. Remember we said that our mu is less than our number, all right? And we're going to shade to the left right here. So your left boundary would be negative infinity to whatever your t-score is. If you have a two-sided, you're pretty much going to shade left and right, okay? And your left boundary, well, if you do just this left piece, you can do negative infinity to whatever that negative t-score is and double it. Or you can do the right side and double it, but you do need to double it for a two-sided. For a right-sided, you will do to the right, and you're going to have your t-score at the lower level and infinity at the top when you run tcdf. So, calculating p-values. So we'll do second distribution, and then we'll scroll to tcdf on the calculator, and then you enter your lower, your right, your left, your right, and your degrees of freedom. So T left is the lower boundary of the shaded area, T right is the upper boundary of the shaded area, and DF is your degrees of freedom, which is N minus 1. And this will give you the probability for getting the statistic within the specified cutoffs and degrees of freedom. Okay, your conclusions are almost identical as what we did in the previous lesson with either a z-test for a mean. It's pretty much the same for a t-test for a mean. So basically, we're looking at low p-values. Low p-values surprise us. And if they surprise us, we reject our assumptions and we change our mind. So again, because our p-value is less than 0.05, we would reject H-naught. There's convincing evidence that the true mean of whatever it is actually something else. Now, if our p-values are high, if the probability of getting something is high, you know, really high, then we're like, I'm not so surprised. So you didn't change my mind. I fail to reject what I was already thinking, H-naught. There is insufficient evidence that the true mean is whatever the alternate says. Okay, so let's go ahead and revisit our coffee machine, and we're going to calculate the t-statistic. Now, I'm going to show you some shortcuts to do this, but I'm going to show you the mechanics, too, in case you're asked to show how to calculate a t or whatever. But honestly, the calculator or GeoGebra or Stablet can actually get you all of the statistics pretty easily. The trick is being able to interpret them. So we got one var stats here. I just put these all on the list, and I have my average, my standard deviation. Remember, that's the S, not the sigma. N is 20, so my degrees of freedom, we have to subtract 1 from that. Then to get the S for the average, I divide by square root of 20. Now, I could have done that in the formula, just had it all in one spot. I just hate having square roots down here. Don't know why. So there's my X bar minus my mu, because that's my hypothesized value, that 10 right there. This is my standard error divided by the square root of the sample size, and that's down there. And so I get negative 3.49, which is kind of, if we remember our z-scores, that's kind of far away. It's going to be a little different for our t, though, because we have 19 degrees of freedom, which is not super big, and we get a value of 0.0012, all right? So our p-value, that's our p-value. It's lower than our alpha, so we're going to reject our null. There's strong evidence that the mean amount of coffee dispensed by this machine is actually less than the stated 10 ounces. All right, so performing a t-test using a list of data, how do we get these p-values? Well, you can enter your data in a list by pressing stat. So I'm going to go ahead and fill these in, and then edit, enter your data in list 1, stat, and scroll to 2 t-test. Make sure we put in data. You're going to be prompted for the hypothesized mean, which list your data is in. Frequency, almost always 1. Almost always 1. I've never, occasionally you could have a list of frequencies. And then for mu, that doesn't mean what is the mean. It wants to know what your alternate hypothesis is. So I'll show you here on the calculator. So test, and then we're going to go t-test. Notice we have data. Hypothesized mean is 10. I actually have a list of data for the coffee cups, I believe. And we're going to say that we are suspicious that it's less than, I believe. And then calculate. Or you can hit draw, actually. And it will show you, there is your t test statistic, and there is your p-value. So there you go. And the reason you don't see very much shaded, it's way off over here and there's very little to shade. Now you can also do the same thing with stats. So you do stat and scroll to t-test like we did before. Then instead of data, you have stats. Make sure you hit enter. You put in the hypothesized mean. you put in the sample mean, because this time before, when you put in the data, it was like, oh, I'll calculate the sample mean for you. But since you don't have the data, you need to give it a mean. You also need to give it the standard deviation, or really standard error from the sample. Make sure that's an S, not a sigma. Enter the sample size for N, and then pick whichever form matches your alternate hypothesis, and it will spit out the values for you. Now, another applet which you can do, and I'll have a link on the website to the GeoGebra applet and on your WebAssign, is a t-test of a mean using GeoGebra. So this one does use statistics. So if you have a list of data, you're better off on the calculator or using Staplet. And I'll also have instructions on the Staplet on the website, so you can check that out. Okay, so if you're doing the GeoGebra with the link that I'm going to give you, you select t-test of a mean, so that's the drop down there. For the null, you put in what your hypothesized mean is, which is the 10. Then we're saying we're concerned that it's less than 10 ounces, so I actually click on this button right here. For the sample mean, just put in the mean from the sample, which in our case was 9.845, and the standard error from the sample as well, making sure to adjust for sample size, all right? And you may need one var stats to calculate that, okay? And then you enter the sample size, and the p-value is this last number here. I'll highlight it. This is the p-value, right? And it's the last number in your report, and it also provides a test statistic t. All right, let's go ahead and we're going to look at doing something on the calculator. And basically, I went ahead and I put all these values in the calculator in list one and ran a t-test. All right, and it spits these values out to me. And then looking at the p-value, I can conclude that our p-value 0.238 is actually pretty high. And that means we fail to reject the null. There's not enough evidence that the mean battery life exceeds 300 minutes. It does not appear that the company has met its goal.